Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Red Limit Freeway by John DeChancie. Narrated by Rudy, Sanda. 1. There they were, up ahead. The trees at the edge of the sky. That's what Winnie called them. Other people called them different things. Kerr-Tipler objects, toll booths, non-catastrophic singularities, portal arrays. I called them cylinders. That's what they were. Big ones. Some as high as 5 kilometers. They were lined up on both sides of the roadway like impossibly huge fence posts. Their color, impossibly black. Blacker than the interstellar space they bent and twisted and warped to their creator's ends, and to our benefit. Everything about them was incredible. They were said to be spinning at unimaginable speeds, though their featureless surfaces gave no perceivable confirmation of this. A few experiments had been done on them, measuring Doppler shifts of infalling particles and Hawking radiation flying out. But the colonial authority had a long-standing ban on the publication of data and even theoretical studies concerning the portals. One only had rumors to go by. And the rumors were, the results were impossible. Their rotational speeds worked out to be faster than light. It couldn't be, but that's what the numbers said.
What's our speed, Sam?
Oh, we're moseying along nicely. If you'd care to move your eyeballs a few millimeters to the right, you'd see for yourself.
You know I can't read instruments and drive at the same time.
Good Lord, and I was just about to offer you some chewing gum.
Oh, cut the merd, Sam.
Is that any way to speak to your father?
Then Sam guffawed in that scratchy, liquid, synthesized voice of his. If the oxymoron can be forgiven, it's the only way I can express what the sound is like. In no way does it resemble my deceased father's voice, except in emotional tone and inflection. I didn't have a recording of Sam to pattern the waveforms after when I ordered the voice output software for the rig's computer. Sam went on.
We're right in the groove. Forget the numbers. I've got her on speed lock.
I glanced at the digital telltales, the array of numbers suspended in the air at eye level and at about 30 degrees to either side of my line of sight straight ahead. Positioned so as to hide in the retinal blind spot, they were unobtrusive until looked at directly. I usually had them turned off. If you moved your head a lot, they seemed like pesky fireflies flitting about. Okay, fine. Everybody strapped in? Roland Yi was in the shotgun seat.
Check, he said.
I think we're all secure back here, John Sakuma Taylor reported.
I chanced to look back. John, Susan DiArcangelo, and Darla Petrovsky, née Vance, were in harnesses in the back seats. The cab accommodated 5 comfortably. I heard squabbling in the aft cabin, a little living space useful for long hauls.
Hey! Carl, I yelled. Is Laurie strapped down back there?
Like trying to hogtie a... Give me your damn arm! Like trying to wrestle a she-cat!
Laurie, I shouted. Be a good girl.
I'm okay, for God's sake. Let me... Gotcha. I'm okay, I'm telling you.
Look, you had a concussion, Carl told her. Now, behave, or we wrap you in confetti and ship you with the rest of the load.
Oh, get folded. Think I don't know what that means? Should be ashamed of yourself. Punk you.
Such language. And from a mere slip of a girl, too.
I had insisted that Laurie be strapped to my bunk during portal transitions. She'd taken a nasty whack on the head back on Splash during our escape from the ship Sea Monster Laputa. I wanted to take no chances. Shooting an aperture can be rough sometimes. And it wasn't at all clear whether Laurie was completely all right. She had been complaining of headaches. Normal enough, but I wanted to be sure. She needed to be looked over. However, we had to leave Splash in a hurry, and the next planet up, Snowball, lived up to its name. No one and practically no thing lived there. We were now on what Winnie's itinerary poem called The Land of Nothing to See, per Darla's translation.
You called it, Winnie.
The planet, or this part of it, looked like the old photographs of Mars I used to pore over as a kid. A place of vast, rock-strewn plains with sand sifted in between the rubble, kilometer after endless kilometer of it. Except the sand was a crappy gray-green instead of an alluring alien red. But there were beings here. Probably humans, if the occasional mail-order pop-up domes far off the road were any indication. These were the consolidated outworlds, a maze of planets linked by the Skyway, but with no way back to Terran maze. No way home. But I wasn't thinking of that just then. One of my pesky hologram readouts was blinking yellow.
What the hell's that, Sam?
It's that damn left front roller, Jake. We get a yellow every time we go into portal approach mode. Been getting one for, couple of months now. You'd know that if you'd deign to take a look at your instruments once in a while.
I didn't notice it. You're right. I fly by the seat of my pants a little too much. Think we should stop?
The book says we should.
I looked out over the bleak terrain.
And do what?
I'm only telling you what the book says.
Well, we'll have to risk it. It's done okay up to now.
Fine. But if she goes sugar donut on us while we're shooting a portal, don't say I...
Didn't warn you, I finished. Right. Sam, you're covered.
It's all the same to me, you know. I'm already dead.
The road ahead was a black ribbon leading straight through the cylinders. They towered above, their tops festooned in wispy clouds against a greenish sky. Their color was black, utterly black. Their surfaces sucked clean of light. It almost hurt to look at them directly, not just physically, but philosophically. To gaze upon an absolute is discomforting. We're too used to fudging, finding refuge in the interstices of things, content to see the universe in shades of gray.
You could see all sorts of frightening possibilities in that categorical darkness if you stopped to look and think.
One thing you don't want to do is stop and philosophize near a portal. You might achieve a total and very unpleasant oneness with your object of contemplation.
Darla, what's Winnie's description of the next planet up?
A land like home, but it isn't, I think.
Does that mean jungle?
Yeah, well, I guess so, I answered myself.
I just hope there's some kind of civilization. I want Lori to get checked out.
Does Lori know anything about this part of the Outworlds? John asked.
No, Darla said. She told me she hasn't seen much besides her home planet and Splash.
Well, I said, she won't have too much trouble getting back to Splash if she wants to go. Unless this is a potluck portal.
I looked at the rearview monitor. Traffic was still behind us.
But I can't believe all these people are following us into oblivion. This portal must go somewhere.
We'll all have some decisions to make about where we're going, John said. Once we stop.
If there's a place to pull over up ahead, I'll do it, I told him. We can talk things over.
I'd just love to get out and stretch my legs, Susan groaned. Seems like we've been driving for ages.
Those were unusually long routes between portals, I said. Wonder why.
Judging from the gravity, Roland put in, and the apparent distance to the horizon, I'd say both Snowball and this place are big, low-density planets. Maybe portals have to be positioned so as to balance out the planet's mass.
He shrugged, looking over at me.
Just a wild guess.
Maybe, I said. I've been doing a lot of thinking about portals lately. The Skyway, the cylinders, how the whole system works. Never really gave it much thought before.
Everyone takes the Skyway for granted, John said.
Simply part of the landscape.
We can't be so complacent, Roland said ruefully.
Right, I agreed.
If I never see this damn road again, Susan grumbled, shaking her head.
I'm in sympathy with that, John said. I think we're all road-weary at this point,
he chuckled.
Except for Jake, perhaps. Do star riggers ever get tired of traveling, Jake?
You bet. But after a few years, you just get numb. Most of the time, though, I like it. I like the road.
The commit markers were coming up. Here, they were just white-painted metal posts on either side of the roadway. The road builders hadn't put them there. It was up to local inhabitants to mark the point beyond which it was unsafe to stop. Back in Terran Mace, and in most mazes I'd been in, the markers were more elaborate. Flashing lights, holograms, and such. I checked over the instruments. Everything looked fine. And just as I shifted my eyes to check the yellow warning tag, it began flashing red.
Jake, Sam said quietly.
I see it. Too late to stop. Damn.
What a time for it.
Trouble, Jake? John wanted to know.
A little. We'll be okay, though. I hoped, fervently.
The flashing red didn't mean the roller was going sugar on us, suffering an instantaneous crystallization that could turn the supertraction tread into white congealed powder, but it did mean it could go at any moment. Maybe now, maybe 2 days from now. There was no way to predict. We were past the commit markers and racing for the first pair of cylinders. The safe corridor, a narrow land bounded by two solid white lines, rolled out at us. Cross over either of those lines, and you've had it. The rig shuddered and groaned, caught in the delicately balanced gravitational stresses around us.
Keep her steady, Jake, Sam warned, and be ready for a sudden jump to the right.
The rig shook and buffeted us in our seats.
This is a rough one, Sam commented. Just our luck.
I felt the tug of an unseen hand dragging the rig to the left. I corrected, and suddenly the hand let go, sending us precipitously in the opposite direction. But I was a veteran at this. I hadn't overcorrected, overreacted. This portal was a bit hairy, but I had seen worse. If only the roller would hold. The cylinders marched by, a stately procession of dark monuments. Between them, I knew but couldn't look, the view of the terrain was refracted into crazy funhouse mirror images, work of the powerful gravitational fields. Ahead was the aperture itself, a fuzzy patch of nothingness straddling the road. We shot straight into it. 2. We got through. The ailing roller was still intact, but the flashing red warning stayed on. I shut off the hollow array. Then, I lowered our speed to 50 kilometers per hour, took my crash helmet down from the rack behind the seat, and put it on. I rarely wear it, though I should. The bulky thing is more than a safety helmet. It has submicron chips in it for just about everything. CPUs, communications, short-range scanning, even encephalo-teleoperator circuitry, though I did never buy the rest of the hookup. I prefer to operate machinery hands-on. The thought of just sitting there, steering the rig on a whim in an alpha wave, makes me a little nervous. We had arrived on a world that didn't look much like Winnie's jungle home, and I was beginning to think that her itinerary poem contained some misinformation, until the Skyway plunged from the high plateau we were on into a series of hairpin turns, winding its way down a range of heavily forested mountains. I worried about the roller all the way, taking the curves at a crawl, not wanting to juice up the traction to high grab and aggravate the condition of the bad one. At full charge and maximum traction, I could have roared down there at 80 kilometers per hour, had I a wild hair up my fundamental aperture. The forestation was luxuriant, but not tropical. The trees looked vaguely earth-like from a distance, but the foliage was radically different, and the colors varied from deep turquoise to brilliant aquamarine, with lots of stray pinks and reds mixed in. The effect on the eyes was slightly disturbing, colors shimmering and shifting as the retinal cells vacillated over what wavelengths to take first. I didn't have much time to look. The curves were getting dicey, and I had my hands full. Everyone else gaped out the ports, marveling at the strange palette of colors. I did notice that the trees were enormous, with thick, straight trunks shooting up as high as 100 meters.
Great logging country, Sam said.
I hope there are loggers, Susan said. And I hope they have restaurants to eat in with clean restrooms. And I hope the food is good. And I hope there's a place to stay with nice big beds and...
She broke off and sighed.
Don't mind me.
We could all do with the break, Susie, John commiserated. Laurie yelled something from the back.
What was that, Lorelei?
John called.
I said I have to piss so bad my back teeth are swimming.
Hey, Carl, I began, then realized something. Hey, what the hell is your last name anyway?
Chapin.
Oh. Why don't you let Laurie up and let her use the... Oh, hell. Susie? Susie started to unstrap.
Sure.
I slowed down almost to a stop while Susan went back to make sure Laurie didn't rebang her head on the way to the John. Chapin came up front, as there was no privacy back there. He had joined our group rather recently. Last night, in fact. Since that time, he'd kept pretty much to himself, when not keeping an eye on Laurie. I didn't know if anyone really knew who he was, or why he was with us. For that matter, I was not completely straight on the facts myself. The trip across Splash had taken most of the day, and the trek across Snowball and Nothing to See had eaten up the rest of it. Everyone had been trying to get some sleep, and there had been little conversation. What there had been, Carl had not participated in beyond pleasantries, except when cussing out Laurie. About time you were formally introduced to everyone, Carl, don't you think? Have you met everyone?
I remember you from somewhere, he said to me, wryly.
I smiled. And I seem to have a distant recollection of stealing your buggy.
Oh my God, that car,
John remembered, slapping his forehead and rolling his eyes.
Where in the name of all that's unholy did you get that thing?
That's John Sakuma Taylor, I said. John? Meet Carl Chapin.
Hello. A little belated, but nice to meet you.
Don't get up. Nice to meet you too, John. And it's a little late, but thanks for the help last night.
You're very welcome. But Roland here was responsible for engineering it.
Roland unstrapped, got up, and took Chapin's hand.
Roland Yee. It's a pleasure. Where the hell did you get that car?
Chapin laughed.
I get asked that a lot. I bought it from a custom vehicle manufacturer.
Alien, I suppose?
Yeah.
Who?
Roland asked pointedly.
Well...
The technology was fantastic. You couldn't have gotten it from any known race on the Skyway.
Roland's tone was a trifle accusing. Roland, John interjected.
I think you're being a bit...
I'm sorry.
Roland was quick to go on.
It's just that our whole experience with your vehicle was, well, disconcerting, to say the least.
John nodded.
To say the very least.
I can imagine, Chapin said. But you shouldn't go around stealing things that don't belong to you.
I stole it, Carl, I said. They were kidnapped. Chapin winced, a bit embarrassed.
Oh, sorry.
Natural enough mistake, John said good-naturedly. You couldn't possibly have known.
I had pulled off toward the side of the road and had stopped, waiting for Laurie to get squared away and for everyone to decide to continue the chit-chat sitting down and strapped in. Finally, everyone did. We were short a seat and harness for Chapin, but he wedged himself in behind my seat, squatted on a toolbox, and hung on to a hand grip. Susie even managed to persuade Laurie to bed down again. Laurie didn't protest this time. Not much, anyway. Something occurred to me. Where's Winnie? I hadn't seen her in hours. I yelled for her. We heard the sauna stall door open. Winnie came into the cab, rubbing her eyes, scratching her furred tummy, and giving us all a grimace smile.
Here! Winnie, here!
This is Winnie, I said to Chapin, twisting around to him. Winnie? Carl.
Hi, Winnie.
Hi. Hi.
Chapin held out his hand, and Winnie took it, her double-thumbed grip and folding it warmly.
Where are you from, Winnie?
Chapin asked her. Winnie extended an arm aft, making a far-off motion.
Way back.
Everyone laughed. We had all come a long way. Winnie
sat in Darla's lap. But when she saw that Darla would have some difficulty bearing up under the weight, she jumped over to John's, hugging him. Winnie's compactness was deceptive. She had a good deal of bulk on her.
"You've met Carl, then?" John asked Darla.
"Yes, we talked last night. But I didn't get much out of him."
She smiled at Carl.
"Neither did I," Susan said, strapping in.
"I notice he made a point to meet the women," I commented.
"Don't mean to be so secretive," Carl said. But he left it at that.
"Here we go," I announced.
I goosed the engine and eased the rig forward down the steep incline. Traffic whizzed by, two roadsters hot-rodding through the curves, braying annoyance at the big lumbering rig in their way. A little farther down, the curves got easier to handle, and I got a chance to look at the scenery. The sky was dark with a thick covering of greenish-purple clouds. Here and there, big winged creatures soared just above treetop level, alighting now and then on lofty branches. No other large life forms in sight. It was all very pretty and very alien. The road bottomed out and went straight, following a long, tree-lined corridor. Between the massive black tree trunks, undergrowth grew thickly, even in the dim light. And a few lines came to me. "The woods are lovely, dark, and deep. But I have promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep." If road yarns contained any truth, I had light years to go. For some unfathomable reason, I had become the protagonist of the wildest Skyway story yet. I knew only the outline of it. No one had related it in detail. It was the tale of a man, yours truly, who followed the Skyway clear out to the end, and came back. But in doing so, I returned, paradoxically, before I left. There was more to it. I had come into possession of an alien artifact, the roadmap, which delineated clearly and for all time the extent of the Skyway system and revealed a path leading to the lost civilization of the road builders and the secrets of their phenomenal technology. And where did the Skyway lead, if followed out all the way to the end? As if an interconnected road system could have such. It led, so the story said, to the beginning of the universe. Not to the end, mind you, in either sense. Not the physical limit of the universe or its final destiny, but to the beginning. When I heard that, from Jerry Spax, an old friend and former member of the Starriggers Guild, I asked if there was a good motel there. The beginning of the universe.
Bang! Pack your sunglasses, and bring plenty of suntan lotion. That primeval fireball can burn you right through your pretty new beach outfit.
As far-fetched as it all was, I had every reason, now, to believe it. True, I had only Darla's word that she had met me before, a meeting I did not remember, but I also was now in possession of a very strange object, the nature of which was not clear even to Darla, who had given it to me. I had the black cube. That was all it was, a palm-sized cube, black as the devil's heart, origin and purpose unknown. It might be the roadmap, or it might not be. There was other evidence. Back on Goliath, I had made good my escape from the colonial militia with the very timely help of what could only have been my doppelganger, my paradoxical self. I was fairly sure of that. I had seen him. Me.
True, a tiny wisp of doubt still clung to that image of my own face hovering above me as I lay in my cell, being administered the antidote to the effects of the reticulin dream wand. I sat up in my seat. Where did my double get the dream wand he had used to knock out everybody at the militia station?
I opened the glove box under the dash. There it was. A shiny green shaft with a bright metal ring around one end. Of course. That's how he got it. I have it now. I closed the box. Jesus, it was spooky. Maybe there was no doubt after all.
Hooray!
A sign beside the road. 6 kilometers to the Frumious Bandersnatch. Eats. Get drunk.
We mail you home. Keep your key. Rooms not too sorted. Turn off Skyway 1 kilometer. Follow Route 22 east.
Oh, God, a bed, Susan said dreamily.
The sign's in English, John said. Oh, here's the intersystem one. Odd, it's not as friendly in system.
Frumious bandersnatch, Roland muttered.
Route 22, I nearly missed it, even going at a crawl, was a dirt trail which intersected the Skyway, then meandered off into the forest. I turned off and followed it, bumping over mound and rut, stone and fallen log for what seemed like 20 kilometers with no bandersnatch evident. Nothing was evident but a kind of hokey, enchanted forest scene, as in the animated epics you see in museum Mopix programs. Except, of course, there was nothing ersatz about it. This was the real, otherworldly thing. Out there was the domain of elves, dryads, unicorns, and nymphs, or their funny-looking alien counterparts, and they'd be doubly eldritch for that. We came upon it suddenly. It was a big, rambling, 3-story building slapped together out of immense logs and raw board lumber, roofed over with 6 gables, a spacious canopied porch going all the way around, lots of small windows on the upper floors, all of it anchored by 4 or 5 huge stone chimneys coughing thin black smoke. There was a big parking lot hacked out of the forest on 3 sides, crammed with unusual off-road vehicles. All in all, it had a great deal of charm. Right then, though, a holy tent with no groundcloth would have looked like home. Smells of grilled food were in the air. I had been about to check instruments for air content and quality when I saw 2 husky fellows reel bareheaded out the front door and stagger to their funny-looking land jumper. I let down the port and sniffed. Pleasant odors, some nameless, some familiar. I rather liked this place already.
Anyone hungry? I said.
Hold out your arm, Susan answered, unstrapping hurriedly. And don't bother with the salt.
I was pretty tired of hot-packed dinners and moldy stuff from the cooler, too. We were all packed up and out of the rig and nothing flat. The bad roller looked pretty grim, afflicted with leprous white patches of crystallization. From here on in, every meter it rolled would be a risk. No matter. I was fairly sure there'd be a garage nearby. We'd put on the spare, and not give too much thought to how bad it was. I stood at the edge of the parking lot, checking out escape routes. Habit. A second highway intersected Route 22 here, another logging road, or rabbit trail, I couldn't tell which. Sam had a clear path to leave on short notice if necessary, unless someone parked next to him blocking the road. From the looks of these vehicles, though, he'd have no trouble nudging them aside if he had to. You'd have to see Sam up alongside your average 4-roller buggy to appreciate how big he is. I opened a channel on Sam's key, an oblong orange plastic box that was a radio, among other things.
Okay, Sam. I guess we're staying here overnight. You be all right?
Sure. Have fun. And call me every so often. Leave the beeper on.
Right. I'll patch you through when we go in to eat and lift a few cold ones. We'll have a lot to talk over.
Good.
I closed the key. Susan was beside me, clucking and shaking her head.
Poor Sam, she said.
Eh?
He always has to stay behind, doesn't he? It's sad.
I reopened the key.
Hear that, Sam?
Susie thinks you've got nothing to do all by your lonesome. She's all worried.
Hmm? Oh, hell. Don't worry about me.
Susan reddened.
I meant...
I got a stack of crotch magazines I haven't looked at yet, and let's see, there's that model ship I'm putting together. After I thank yous for the shower gifts, should wash my hair, and I can always wank off.
Susan scrunched up her face in pain.
Oh, you two are terrible.
She ran off, laughing.
Welcome to Toltree.
Thanks, I told the big-boned, flannel-shirted man at the desk.
Good name.
His eyes twinkled.
We stayed up all night to think of it.
I looked around the lobby. It was big, fully 2 stories high with an open beam ceiling. The rugs were sewn animal hides. The furniture looked handmade. The appointments were rustic, yet tasteful.
"Quite a place you have here," I said.
He swelled visibly, and his grin was broad.
"Thank you. It's my pride and joy. Built most of it with my bare hands," he winked. "And a little help."
"Well, you did a good job. I was expecting something more primitive on a planet like this."
"This is one of the most sophisticated log structures on Tall Tree," he informed me. He pointed upward. "I designed those cantilever trusses myself. You can do a lot with the local wood, though. Strong as iron. High tensile strength."
"Interesting."
The lobby was filled with people, young men mostly, joking, hooting, jostling each other. They drank from pewter mugs, sloshing beer onto the floorboards. The crowd appeared to be the overflow from the bar, called the Vorpal Blade.
"I hear a lot of English being spoken," I said.
"Mostly English speakers here," he said. "English, Canadian, Aussie, lots of Irish, a few other breeds. You American stock?"
"Yes, but it's been a long time since I thought of myself as American."
He nodded.
"Time marches on. One day, we'll all be Sabra."
He turned the registration book around.
"Anyway, I do hope you enjoy your stay here at the Bandersnatch, if you'll sign right here. You all together?"
I signed.
"Yes.
What's the local industry around here?" His eyes twinkled again.
"Would it surprise you if I said logging?"
"Not a bit."
I looked back at the crowd of burly young men. Everyone seemed cast to type. He gave me our room keys. They were made of hand-wrought iron. Only 2. Winnie and the women in one room, the men in the other. It was my idea. Tall Tree was part of the Outworlds, and my leftover consolidation gold certificates were still good, but I wanted to economize. I had only a limited amount of gold to trade. The nightly room rates were fairly cheap, though.
"Any way of getting a bite to eat?" I asked.
"It's a little early for the dining room, sir. Our cook's building a flume this week. But the Blade has a separate kitchen and plenty of food. Most of the guests take breakfast and lunch in there. However, you might find it a bit crowded now."
"What's this?" I asked above the noise. "A luncheon party?"
"No, today's a holiday. Feast of St. Charles Dodgson."
He gave me a knowing wink.
"The celebration got started early, like 3 days ago."
"Feast of St. Charles," John began, then broke out laughing. We all did.
On the multiple nationality, ethnic, religious worlds of the Skyway, nobody could agree on what holidays to celebrate. Back in Terran Mace, those officially proclaimed by the colonial authority were scoffingly ignored, except by bureaucrats who took off work. A tradition had arisen to celebrate spurious ones, silly ones, just for fun. People need excuses to goof off, though the thinnest will serve.
"Soon as you freshen up," the clerk continued, "you can join the festivities if you..."
I was looking at the merrymakers, then turned back to the clerk. He was staring at the registry book, into which I had just signed my name. He looked up at me.
"Is that really your name?"
"The alias I use most." When he didn't laugh, I said, "Just kidding. Sure, it's my name."
"You're Jake McGraw? The Jake McGraw?"
Again, my inexplicable fame had checked in before I had.
"I'm the only one I know of."
"You have an onboard computer named Sam?"
"Yep."
"We'll see," he said, nodding thoughtfully. He turned away, but kept eyeing me askance, as if he weren't sure about something.
That was his problem.
But what he would finally believe might be mine. 3. Our rooms on the 2nd floor were primitive, but again, there was antique charm in the rough wall paneling, the quaint lamps, the handmade furniture, beds, night lamps, armoires, and chairs. The beds were especially nice, with simple floral carvings on the headboards. However, Susan didn't like hers.
"Lumpy as hell," she griped. "And the sheets are gray."
"Be patient, princess," Roland teased. "We'll get the pee out from under the mattress later."
"Everyone I know is a comedian. Let's go eat."
They all went downstairs. There was a mirror behind the door to the room, and I paused to look myself over. I was wearing what is, for me, formal dress. My maroon starriggers jacket with its jazzy piping, rakish cut, and little pockets with zippers all over the place. Usually, my attire is medium slovenly, but all my casual clothes had been left behind on various planets. This jacket and the fatigue pants were about all I had left, except for shorts and things I wear when lounging about the rig. The jacket made me feel faintly ridiculous. I looked like a goddamn space cadet. I went down the narrow stairs to the lobby, where the gang was waiting for me. We started for the Vorpal Blade. There were even more people in the lobby now, trying vainly to get in. Just as we hit the edge of the crowd, the desk clerk intercepted us.
"We have a table for you and your party, Mr. McGraw, if you'll follow me."
"A table?" I said incredulously. "In there?"
"Yes, sir, right this way."
I turned to my companions, but they weren't at all surprised. So we followed him as he made a swath for us through the clot of people pressing around the entrance to the bar. He seemed to know just about everyone he either politely brushed by or summarily shoved out of the way, none too gently, when the parties concerned weren't immediately cooperative. His size, even when compared to these beefy loggers, gave him all the authority he needed, if he didn't own the place to boot. The Vorpal Blade was dark, smoky, and noisy, redolent of spilled beer and cooking grease. A huge bar took up one side of the room. The walls were of barkless log, milled flat on the inside, and the ceiling joists were squared off and planed. There were plenty of tables and chairs, but too many damn people, loggers mostly. The decor was apropos. Walls hung with odd varieties of saws, axes, cutting tools of every sort, pairs of spiked climbing boots, ropes, and such. It was a sweaty, muscular, pewter and leather kind of place, awash with good fellowship and camaraderie. Everybody was singing, including the bartenders, and they were busy. The clerk actually had a table for us, with room for all, against the far wall near the bar and directly athwart a huge stone fireplace. We all sat, and I thanked the clerk. I asked him his name, silently wondering if I should tip him. I reached into my pocket.
"Zach Moore, sir. And save thee gratis for the help. Enjoy."
"Thank you, Zach." On his way out, he shooed a buxom barmaid over to us, then waved and left.
"Hello there. What are you people having today?"
The others started ordering. I was noticing the alien grain of the wood. It was almost geometrical, oddly shot through with greens and purples, but the overall color was a dark brown. Didn't look as though the wood had been stained. I knocked a knuckle against the wall. It felt like iron. I turned around, sat back, and listened to the group sing along. Odd lyrics. A group at a table near the bar sang the verses, the rest of the crowd taking up the chorus, which went something like, "A lumberjack can't take a wife, such a terribly lonely life, for a logger's best friend is a tree. It's strange, I know, but it's all right by me." Each verse grew progressively more absurd and off-color. Transvestism and other variations were broadly hinted at. Individual poetasters stood up and sang their own verses, each more outrageous than the last. The crowd howled. After the last verse, they'd sing it all over again, adding more verses. I asked the barmaid where the song had come from. She didn't know, but said in so many words that it was most likely traditional. She'd been hearing it ever since she came to Tall Tree as a child, last Tuesday from the looks of her. But hell, maybe I'm just getting old. We all listened while waiting for our order to come. By the time the beer arrived, Susie and John were convulsed, with Darla and Roland smiling, a little unsure. Carl loved it too. Winnie and Lori were trying to talk above the din. The beer was Inglo style, dark, bitter, served at room temperature, but the high alcohol content more than made up for it. I drained my pewter mug in 3 gulps and refilled it from the glazed crockery pitcher. Only when the food came did I think about Winnie. She certainly couldn't eat this stuff. Braised pork ribs, roast game hen, fried potatoes and vegetables, sliced warm bread with mounds of fresh butter. The barmaid told us that almost nothing on the planet was edible without extensive processing. All the fare before us had been raised on local farms. Lori came over and shouted in my ear.
Winnie wants to go outside. Says she can find something to eat.
Here? I shouldn't have been surprised, but I was. Well, okay, but I should go with you.
We'll be fine. You go ahead and eat. I'm not very hungry.
How's your head? Still feeling woozy?
Nah, I'm fine.
Okay, but be careful.
I was reluctant to let them go, and briefly considered asking Roland to tail them and keep an eye on them, but I knew Lori was fiercely independent for her age, and more, I had come to consider Winnie the equal of an adult human in intelligence and maturity, maybe even more than equal. Lori could do very well on her own. However, I still wanted her to be checked over by a competent medic if one could be found. That was a minor problem. The big one was what the hell to do with her. With the Laputa either lost or pirated, she had no place to go except to her former foster parents' home on a planet named Schlagwasser, which lay on Winnie's itinerary. Unfortunately, Lori had not been on good terms with her foster parents and had run away. But it wasn't certain that the Laputa had been lost. Good for Lori, maybe, but not good for me. At least 3 groups of people and beings aboard that strange ship animal wanted my blood. In regard to the alien party, that could be taken quite literally. The Reticulans practiced ritual hunting in bands known as snatch gangs and dispatched their captured quarry by ceremonial vivisection. If Corey Wilkes, their human ally, had survived, he'd still be teamed with the Rickies to get the roadmap from me. And then there was the Laputa's master, Captain Pendergast, who had been in cahoots with Wilkes and Darla's father, the late Dr. Van Wyck Vance, in a scheme to run anti-geronic drugs into the Outworlds. To those who wanted to keep these consolidated Outworlds isolated from Terran Maze and independent of the Authority, the roadmap represented a threat. Doubtless Pendergast viewed it as such, but he might yet be unaware of Wilkes's betrayal. Wilkes wanted the map to give to the Authority in return for, among other things, amnesty for his part in the drug operation. Pendergast was not alone in his desire for a free Outworlds. He most likely shared it with every inhabitant of this maze. After all, everyone here had taken a desperate gamble in shooting a potluck portal to get here. There was a way back to Terran Maze by Skyway. Problem was, it went through Reticulan Maze, where few humans, or any rational human who wanted to keep his skin intact, dared to go. But it was a fair possibility that a bold or foolish few had braved the trip back and had lived to tell of what was on the other side of the potluck portal on Seven Suns Interchange, though that might be only one of several portals leading into the Outworlds. The upshot? If the Laputa had made it, the problem of what to do with Lori would evaporate. But I just might too. Problems, problems. What would the teleologists, John, Susan, and Roland, do now? That would take priority on the agenda, after we had eaten. The food was great. Ribs spicy and done just right. The game hen crispy skinned and juicy inside. The bread was golden brown with a thick crust, flaky and tender. And the vegetables were there to pass the time between bouts of wolfing down the entrees, with draft after draft of beer to sluice it all down the pipes. If this was bar food, I wondered what delights the dining room offered. The waitress kept bringing side dishes, compliments of the house, she said. Along with free rounds of beer came bowls of sliced pickled beets, onions,
pickled eggs and cucumbers, multi-bean salad, assorted condiments, and piles of bread and butter. On the downside, we were getting stared at. It wasn't our table manners. In that regard, we fit right in. Word had spread, I thought, as to who I was, which immediately brought to mind the question of just who the hell I was. Jake McGraw, Olympian god type, who came back through time to bring the secret of the road builders to mankind? Just a man around whom a cloud of wild rumors had settled? Or was I being confused with someone else? No, the latter two possibilities were out. The Black Cube, the Paradox of Darla, and other realities spoke volumes about the rumors being true. Some of them, anyway. That left the Olympian hero. Anybody got a fig leaf? Finally, the singing stopped, and all the food was gone. I was stuffed and halfway drunk. I don't like doing things halfway. We ordered more beer.
My God, John breathed, sitting back and massaging his stomach. I can't remember ever eating so much at one time. Hope I won't...
He burped liquidly.
Oh, excuse me.
Bring it up again and we'll vote on it,
Laurie said, returning with Winnie.
I can't believe you found food, Darla said.
Winnie smiled and waved a handful of plum-sized pink fruit with blue speckles all over them. Laurie dumped a pile of leaves and stems down on the table and sat down.
Eat up, folks!
Everyone groaned.
Here, honey, I saved you some chicken, Susan said, sliding a plate toward her. Kinda small for chicken, but thanks.
It's game fowl, Susan, Roland corrected. Raised domestically.
Whatever.
How did Winnie know...
John motioned vaguely at the pile of vegetation.
How does Winnie know everything? Roland countered. Including accurate descriptions of planets she's never visited.
I'll have to talk it over with her, Darla said thoughtfully. Apparently, there's more information in that poem of hers than I've been able to get out.
Maybe the poem and the map and this kind of information, John offered. What to eat along the way and that sort of thing. Maybe you could consider it all a... well, what would you call it? A tourist guide kit?
Very good, John, Roland said. Very good.
Boy, those woods out there are spooky,
Laurie said through a mouthful of game hen.
Kept getting funny... I don't know... feelings.
Did you see any white rabbits? Roland asked.
Nah, didn't actually see anything.
Hey, this is good.
You should eat, honey, Susan said motheringly.
You haven't taken a bite all day.
I'm eating.
Sorry, Laurie, I didn't mean... Oh, it's okay. I'm sorry.
We watched Winnie take a tentative bite of fruit and roll it around her tongue. Not bad. She chewed it briskly and popped the rest into her mouth. We all looked at one another and shrugged. John leaned back.
Well,
he said, as if to start something off.
Yes, well, Roland seconded.
What are you folks going to do now? I asked.
I've been thinking, John began.
Thought I smelled something burning,
Laurie mumbled. I think she had John pegged as somewhat of a stuffed shirt, which he was. Susan tittered, and Roland smiled before he said seriously,
I'm for keeping with Jake. I think if you examine all our options, it's the best one.
Hold off now, John cautioned, raising a hand. Why don't we examine them all and see?
The linkages are there, Roland asserted. Everything seems to have gone according to plan.
I'm not so sure of that.
It's fairly obvious.
Not to me, I'm afraid, John said gently.
Forgive me, Roland.
Roland sighed.
I suppose my task is to make you see the overall design.
I want to learn from you, Roland. I really do. But, please, let's make it an exchange. Agreed?
Roland nodded.
You're right. I have been doing a lot of pontificating lately.
He gave John a conciliatory grin.
Let's go over our options.
Well, for one,
John slapped the table. We can try to find the planet where the Ricks launched those starships. We may be able to get back to Terran Maze that way. The second way to get back from a supposedly one-way portal. Go through normal space. Back in Terran Maze, nobody knew of this, and the Ricks must have taken great pains not to let on, probably in order to protect their monopoly on trade with the Outworlds, though they could have had other reasons. I knew of no other race who bothered to build starships. The Skyway made them superfluous. The Ricks would probably hold their monopoly even if everyone knew they were doing it. That may be worth exploring, I put in, just to satisfy your curiosity and cover all bets, but I wouldn't hold out any great hopes for it. How much money have you got? John gave me a dour look.
Jake?
Sorry. Just trying to point out that passage on a sub-light-speed starship has to run high. Even if they do take passengers, which I somehow doubt, there could be a long waiting list. From the little I know of starship design, weight and space would be critical.
Didn't Wilkes say he was going? John asked.
I wouldn't take anything Wilkes said without a truckload of salt. He may have been lying, maybe not. Keep this in mind. He was, or is still, for all I know, a very well-connected man. He may have cut a special deal.
Maybe.
John drummed the table with spidery fingers.
Well, I don't know. Maybe we could get jobs, work up our passage money, approach the Ricks and make a deal ourselves. Plead our case.
The corner of Susan's lips curled sourly.
We have a great sob story. I'm simply outlining the alternatives, Susan. Oh, go ahead, John. Don't mind me.
Bear with me, please.
Now, back on Splash...
I wouldn't go back there, I said.
Maybe not Splash. Some other place. Here, for instance. There's always the option of settling here, or on some world where we can get a community going.
The three of us, Roland said skeptically.
Three, or two, or even one, Roland. Isn't that what teleological pantheism is all about?
Roland acknowledged the point with a tilt of his head. John ruminated for a moment, then went on.
I see what you're saying. We'd be cut off. No funds, no communication with our group on Khadija, or with our organization back on Terra. It would be difficult.
Rather, no money, no immediate prospects of getting any, no place to stay except with Jake. We need supplies and literature to stock a reading center.
John turned to me.
I think I told you we do no proselytizing, but one of our chief functions is to open up and run a reading room and consultation center. That's what we were about to do when we had the mishap with the militia back on Goliath. After visiting our colleague in the hospital, we were going to see about renting a little storefront in town.
Susan had been thinking.
What about sending a message back by starship? If we could only let Sten or somebody know what happened to us.
Yes, John said, the idea dawning on him.
Yes, that's a marvelous thought. Don't know why I didn't think of it. We simply must get word back somehow. If we could let our community know that there's something here on the other side...
Again, I said. You can try, but again, I doubt it would work. The Ricks don't seem to want anyone to know about the Outworlds. They may have been willing to take Wilkes back, but that might only have been because they were in on the drug operation. Anyway, I seriously doubt whether they're in the mail business. John and Susan looked deflated.
I wouldn't give up hope, I hastened to add. I didn't want to be too hard on them because what I had to tell them next would be pretty rough.
We know nothing for sure. And the most important thing we're not clear on is whether any of us are safe anywhere in the Outworlds. Susan's face blanched.
What do you mean, Jake?
Although I was nearly drunk, I had been giving the whole matter some thought. First of all, we don't know what became of the Laputa. I turned to Lori. What would have happened if the Arfi pirates had taken over the ship?
I don't know. It never happened before.
You have no idea what would have become of the passengers?
No, but I wouldn't put it past Arfies to do something terrible. Some of them are okay, but others...
But the ship has always managed to beat off these attacks, right?
Yeah.
So, I went on, turning back to John and his confreres, there's every possibility that everyone aboard that ship who is hot on my tail is alive and well and desirous of my blood. All of you are in danger because of your association with me. And that goes for Lori, too. And Carl. John shook his head slowly, exasperation in his voice.
But surely there's somewhere in the outworlds we could hide. I simply can't believe...
Hide? From the Reticulans? The three Teelys looked grimly at me, then at each other. I hate to bring it up, I said, but we're going to have to proceed on the assumption that all of us are sacred quarry. That put a damper on the conversation for a while. I remembered I hadn't checked in with Sam.
About time.
Sorry, we were discussing what we should do. I think we've agreed that everyone should stick together for now.
A good idea.
And we should try to get word on what happened to the Laputa. Is there anything on the air here in the way of news?
No commercial or government stations, but there's an extensive sky band and amateur radio network. I've been monitoring all channels. Nothing on the Laputa so far.
Well, there's a lot of traffic between here and Splash, and that ferry boat served a vital function. If she were lost, it'd be big news. Something should turn up.
Right. I'll keep monitoring. Leave the key open, okay?
Sure. I put it on the table and activated the micro camera to give him something to look at.
Nice place. The food any good?
Great, Darla told him.
Someone in the crowd had stood up and was speaking. He was like the rest. Thick-thewed. Long, mussy hair. Dressed in a plaid flannel shirt and dungarees.
Gentlemen, gentlemen, and ladies, if I may use both terms so loosely.
He leered and stroked his wiry red beard. Rude noises from the crowd.
I now call this joint plenary meeting of the Brotherhood of the Boojum and the Sorority of the Snark to order.
Shouts, jeers, applause.
Order. I will have order. Sergeant at arms. Will you please see to it that any objectionable behavior is dealt with according to the bylaws of this organization?
Something, hulking in a sheepskin jacket, stood up and surveyed the crowd menacingly. He got no takers. Everyone shut up.
Thank you, Brother Flaherty.
The Hulk sat down as the one with the red beard took a long pull from his mug, draining it.
To bear is no closed,
he pronounced, banging the mug down on the tabletop.
Boo! Be reasonable, old man. Who cares? We got three pitchers.
He ignored it.
I now call upon Brother Finch to read the minutes of the last meeting.
Another logger lurched to his feet.
The bloody stupid meeting was called to order by acting President Brother Fitzgore. The minutes of the last bloody stupid meeting were read. Weren't any old business, weren't any new business. The bloody stupid meeting was adjourned, and we all got drunk as bloody skunks.
Brother Finch sat down heavily.
I thank Brother Finch for that succinct, bare-to-the-bones summation of the salient developments of the last meeting. Do I have a motion to accept Brother Finch's report as it stands?
I so move.
I second the motion.
The motion has been made and seconded to read Brother Finch's report into the record without emendation. May I now assume that the membership will assent to do so without a vote? Are there any objections?
Someone stood up.
I object to the minutes of the last meeting being exactly the same as the minutes of the preceding meeting, and the one before that. In fact, they're always the same damn minutes.
Fitzgore raised an imperious eyebrow.
Do you take issue with the contents of Brother Finch's report? No, the report is accurate as it stands. I merely object to his lack of originality and literary style. It is not Brother Finch's duty to be original, but to record the facts accurately and without bias.
Fitzcore bellowed. He took a deep breath.
And as for style, I think Brother Finch's prose is almost Homeric in its brilliant use of epithet.
Almost what?
What the hell's an epaulette?
At any rate, Fitzcore continued airily, your objection is overruled.
This is not a court of law. I demand that my objection be entered in the record.
So be it, Fitzcore acceded. Let it be noted in the record that Brother MacLaird has objected to Brother Finch's literary style, or lack thereof.
I ain't got a bloody pencil, Brother Finch said. Someone threw a pencil at him. He caught it neatly, snapped it in two between thumb and forefinger, and threw it back.
Who the hell are these weirdos? Sam said.
Is there any old business? Fitzcore asked.
I got a boil on me bum.
Any new business?
I still got a boil on me bum.
Laughs.
I move we adjourn, someone shouted.
Since no new business has been brought up by the membership, I would like to call the following matter to the membership's attention, if I may be permitted.
According to the rules of procedure, the acting president must always entertain a motion to adjourn from any member.
Not, Fitzcore retorted, when said acting president can beat said member's arse to a bloody pulp any time he so desires.
You and what regiment of the Home Guard?
Cheers for the Home Guard.
This matter can be settled later, but as for now...
Outside in 5 minutes, Fitzcore.
I will be honoured, Fitzcore acknowledged. As I was saying...
Oh, not again. Last time they were so snuggled they couldn't see the swing at one another.
As I was saying, Fitzcore roared.
Then he cleared his throat and wiped his forehead with a sleeve.
Brothers and sisters, he said quietly. It is not often, rather, I should say, it is unprecedented for us to have among us as a guest.
He paused for effect, his heads turned, searching the room.
A figure of, how shall I put it? A figure of such epic stature. But that is the case.
Who? Someone wanted to know, but many eyes were on me.
The Skyway, Fitzcore continued in stentorian tone, abounds with legends, myths, tall tales, apocrypha, and general foolishness, all of which are to be taken with a grain of salt, if not the whole bloody cellar and the bloody mine it came from.
I think I'm going to puke, Sam declared.
But it is rare that one has the profound honour, the exhilarating pleasure of meeting a protagonist of one of these sagas in the flesh. However, that is our honour and our pleasure this day. Brothers and sisters, may I present to you, and would you join me in drinking a toast of honour of...
You closed the pumpkin bar, you dolt!
Fitzcore refilled his mug from a nearby pitcher.
Then I open it again.
Everyone raised his mug.
Join me in a toast to that giant of a legend, that king of the Skyway, the man who drove into the raging fires of the burning universe and lived to tell the tale.
He turned to face me.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I present to you, Jake McGraw.
4. I frankly can't remember all of what went on that night. I know a great deal of alcohol found its way into my system. Events, as I perceived them, became rather diffuse. Fitzcore and his compatriots turned out to be very good drinking companions. Excellent drinking companions. They bought all of us a round of drinks. We bought all of them a round of drinks. Everybody bought everybody a round of drinks. Serious drinking then commenced. At some point, I found in my field of vision the wavering image of a stein of beer fully 3 hands high. They called it the Brobdingnagian Thunder Cup. I drank it. That was quite late in the evening, I think. Before that, we did a lot of talking. They wanted to know everything about me, about the roadmap, about everything. I introduced them to Winnie. She's the map, I said. Fine, they said.
Let's trot out pencil and paper and see what she knows. Pencil and paper were trotted out. Winnie proceeded to show her stuff, looking like a kindergartner learning the rudiments of writ, pink tongue protruding as she executed cramped figures with arduous dedication. She filled page after page with spirals and other shapes connected by lines.
By God, Fitzgore said. Tust a local group. It must be.
He stroked his psychotic growth of red beard.
Damn it all. If we had a library on this planet, we could get books to check this.
He tossed off half a stein of beer.
If we had books on this planet.
I think I've got a few astronomy books in the rig. Matter of fact, there should be a whole crate of them. That right, Sam?
Yeah, our manifest shows a shipment of book pipettes. But you don't really want to go back there and...
Sure I do.
Oh, for pity's sake.
Jake, Roland said, maybe later when we're all sober. This array has to be the local group. Look, here's the Magellanic Clouds, and let's see... Right here would have to be Andromeda and Messier 33.
Who's not sober?
And these two little puffy things are probably Leos 1 and 2. Over here are the galaxies in Sculptor and Fornex.
Who needs books? A toothless logger with a strine accent said. When you got this cobra. Roland is a book.
Thanks, Susie. And all these lines, Roland went on, are Skyway routes. But the interesting question is this. What is this major route coming in from this direction and going off here? Seems to be a major road.
Very likely, Fitzgore said. Look at these other things when he's done. Could these be galactic clusters?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.